Tess of the D'Urbervilles by Thomas Hardy, read by Adrian Pretzellis. Chapter 4. Rolliver's Inn, the single ale-house at this end of the long and broken village, could only boast of an off-licence. Hence, as nobody could legally drink on the premises, the amount of overt accommodation for consumers was strictly limited to a little board about 6 inches wide and 2 yards long, fixed to the garden palings by pieces of wire so as to form a ledge. On this board thirsty strangers deposited their cups as they stood in the road and drank, and threw the dregs on the dusty ground to the pattern of Polynesia, and wished they could have a restful seat inside. Thus the strangers. But there were also local customers who felt the same wish, and where there's a will, there's a way. In a large bedroom upstairs, the window of which was thickly curtained with a great woollen shawl lately discarded by the landlady, Mrs. Rolliver, were gathered on this evening nearly a dozen persons, all seeking beatitude. All old inhabitants of the nearer end of Marlott, and frequenters of this retreat. Not only did the distance to the Pure Drop, the fully licensed tavern at the further part of the dispersed village, render its accommodation practically unavailable for dwellers at this end, but the far more serious question, the quality of the liquor, confirmed the prevalent opinion that it was better to drink with Rolliver in a corner of the housetop rather than with the other landlord in a wide house. A gaunt four-post bedstead which stood in the room afforded sitting place for several persons gathered around three of its sides. A couple more men had elevated themselves on a chest of drawers, another rested on the oak-carved coffer, two on the washstand, another on the stool, and thus all were, somehow, seated at their ease. The stage of mental comfort to which they had arrived by this hour was one wherein their souls expanded beyond their skins, and spread their personalities warm through the room. In this process the chamber and its furniture grew more and more dignified and luxurious. The shawl hanging at the window took upon itself the richness of tapestry. The brass handles of the chest of drawers were as golden knockers, and the carved bedposts seemed to have some kinship with the magnificent pillars of Solomon's temple. Mrs. Durbeyfield, having quickly walked hitherward after parting from Tess, opened the front door, crossed the downstairs room, which was in deep gloom, and then unfastened the stair-door like one whose fingers knew the tricks of the latches well. Her ascent of the crooked staircase was a slower process, and her face, as it rose into the light above the last stair, encountered the gaze of all the party assembled in the bedroom.
"Being a few private friends I've asked to keep up club-walking at my own expense," the landlady exclaimed at the sound of footsteps, as glibly as a child repeating the catechism, while she peered over the stairs. "Oh, 'tis you, Mrs. Durbeyfield. Lord, how you frightened me! I thought it might be some gaffer sent by government."
Mrs. Durbeyfield was welcomed with glances and nods by the remainder of the conclave, and turned to where her husband sat. He was humming absently to himself in a low tone,
"I be as good as some folks here and there. I've got a great family vault at Kingsbere sub Greenhill, and finer skeletons than any man in Wessex."
"I've something to tell you that's come into my head about that, a grand project," whispered his cheerful wife. "Here, John, don't he see me?"
She nudged him, while he, looking through her as though through a window-pane, went on with his recitative.
"Hush! Don't ee sing so loud, my good man," said the landlady, "in case any member of the government should be passing and take away my license."
"He's told ee what's happened to us, I suppose?" asked Mrs. Durbeyfield.
"Yes, in a way. Do you think there's any money hanging by it?"
"Ah, that's the secret," said Joan Durbeyfield sagely.
"However, 'tis well to be kin to a coach, even if you don't ride in 'en."
She dropped her public voice, and continued in a low tone to her husband,
"I've been thinking, since you brought the news, that there's a great rich lady out by Trantridge, on the edge of the Chase, of the name of d'Urberville."
"Eh? What's that?" said Sir John.
She repeated the information.
"That lady must be our relation," she said, "and my project is to send Tess to claim kin."
"There is a lady of that name, now you mention it," said Durbeyfield. "Pa'son Tringham didn't think of that, but she's nothing beside we, a junior branch of us, no doubt, hailing long since King Norman's day."
While this question was being discussed, neither of the pair noticed, in their preoccupation, that little Abraham had crept into the room, and was awaiting an opportunity of asking them to return.
"She's rich, and she'd be sure to take notice of the maid," continued Mrs. Durbeyfield, "and 'twill be a very good thing. I don't see why two branches of one family should not be on visiting terms." "Yes, and we'll all claim kin," said Abraham brightly from under the bedstead, "and we'll all go to see her when Tess has gone to live with her, and we'll ride in her coach and wear black clothes."
"How do you come here, child? What nonsense be ye talking? Go away and play on the stairs till father and mother be ready."
"Well, Tess ought to go to this other member of our family. She'd be sure to win the lady, Tess would, and likely enough 'twould lead to some noble gentleman marrying her. In short, I know it."
"How?"
"I tried her fate in the fortune-teller, and it brought out that very thing. You should have seen how pretty she looked to-day. Her skin was as simple as a duchess's."
"What says the maid herself to go in?"
"I've not asked her. She don't know there is any such lady relation yet, and it would certainly put her in the way of a grand marriage, and she won't say nay to going."
"Tess is queer."
"But she's tractable at bottom. Leave her to me."
Though this conversation had been private, sufficient of its import reached the understandings of those around to suggest to them that the Durbeyfields had weightier concerns of talk now than common folks had, and that Tess, their pretty eldest daughter, had fine prospects in store.
"Tess is a fine figure of fun, as I said to myself to-day when I zeed her vamping round parish with the rest,"
observed one of the elderly boozers in an undertone.
"But Joan Durbeyfield must mind that she don't get green malt in floor."
It was a local phrase which had a peculiar meaning, and there was no reply. The conversation became inclusive, and presently other footsteps were heard crossing the room below.
"Being a few private friends asked in to-night to keep up club-walking at my own expense."
The landlady had rapidly reused the formula she kept on hand for intruders before she recognised that the newcomer was Tess. Even to her mother's gaze the girl's young features looked sadly out of place amid the alcoholic vapours which floated here as no unsuitable medium for wrinkled middle age, and hardly was a reproachful flash from Tess's dark eyes needed to make her father and mother rise from their seats, hastily finish their ale, and descend the stairs behind her. Mrs. Rolliver's caution followed their footsteps.
"No noise, please, if ye be so good, my dears, or I may lose my license, and be summoned, and I don't know what all. Night to ye."
They went home together, Tess holding one arm of her father, and Mrs. Durbeyfield the other. He had, in truth, drunk very little, not a fourth of the quantity which a systematic tippler could carry to church on a Sunday afternoon without a hitch in his eastings or genuflections. But the weakness of Sir John's constitution made mountains of his petty sins in this kind. On reaching the fresh air, he was sufficiently unsteady to incline the row of three at one moment, as if they were marching to London, and at another as if they were marching to Bath, which produced a comical effect,
frequent enough in families on nocturnal home-goings, and, like most comical effects, not so comic after all. The two women valiantly disguised these forced excursions and countermarches as well as they could from Durbeyfield, their cause, and from Abraham and from themselves, and so they approached by degrees their own door, the head of the family bursting suddenly into his former refrain as he drew near, as if to fortify his soul at sight of the smallness of his present residence.
"I got a family vault at Kingsbere."
"Hush, don't be so silly, Jacky," said his wife. "Yours is not the only family that was of count in old days. Look at the Anktills and the Horseys and the Tringhams themselves, gone to seed almost as much as you, though you was bigger folks than they, that's true. Thank God I was never of no family, and have nothing to be ashamed of in that way."
"Don't you be so sure of that. From your nater 'tis my belief you've disgraced yourselves more than any of us, and was kings and queens outright at one time."
Tess turned the subject by saying what was far more prominent in her own mind at the moment than thoughts of her ancestry.
"I'm afraid father won't be able to take the journey with the beehives tomorrow so early."
I shall be all right in an hour or two," said Durbeyfield.
It was 11 o'clock before the family were all in bed, and 2 o'clock next morning was the latest hour for starting with the beehives, if they were to be delivered to the retailers of Casterbridge before the Saturday market began, the way thither lying by bad roads over a distance of between 20 and 30 miles, and the horse and wagon being of the slowest. At 1:30 Mrs. Durbeyfield came into the large bedroom where Tess and all her little brothers and sisters slept.
"The poor man can't go," she said to her eldest daughter, whose great eyes had opened the moment her mother's hand touched the door.
Tess sat up in bed, lost in a vague interspace between a dream and this information.
"But somebody must go," she replied. "It is late for the hives already. Swarming will soon be over for the year, and if we put off taking them till next week's market, the call for them will be past, and they'll be thrown on our hands."
Mrs. Durbeyfield looked unequal to the emergency.
"Some young fellow perhaps would go, one of them who was so much after dancing with you yesterday," she presently suggested. "Oh, no, I wouldn't have it for the world," declared Tess proudly, "and letting everybody know the reason. Why, such a thing to be shamed of! I think I could go if Abraham would go with me to keep me company."
Her mother at length agreed to this arrangement. Little Abraham was aroused from his deep sleep in a corner of the same apartment, and made to put on his clothes while still mentally in the other world. Meanwhile Tess had hastily dressed herself, and the twain, lighting a lantern, went out to the stable. The rickety little wagon was already laden, and the girl led out the horse, Prince, only a degree less rickety than the vehicle. The poor creature looked wonderingly round at the night, at the lantern, at their two figures, as if he could not believe that at that hour, when every living thing was intended to be in shelter and at rest, he was called upon to go out and labour. They put a stock of candle-ends into the lantern, hung the latter to the off-side of the load, and directed the horse onward, walking at his shoulder at first during the uphill parts of the way, in order not to overload an animal of so little vigour. To cheer themselves as well as they could, they made an artificial morning with the lantern, some bread and butter, and their own conversation, the real morning being far from come. Abraham, as he more fully awoke, for he had moved in a sort of trance so far, began to talk of the strange shapes assumed by the various dark objects against the sky, of this tree that looked like a raging tiger springing from a lair, of that which resembled a giant's head. When they had passed the little town of Stourcastle, dumbly somnolent under its thick brown thatch, they reached higher ground. Still higher on their left, the elevation called Bull Barrow, or Beal Barrow, well nigh the highest in South Wessex, swelled into the sky, engirdled by its earthen trenches. From hereabout the long road was fairly level for some distance onward. They mounted in front of the wagon, and Abraham grew reflective.
"Tess?"
he said in a preparatory tone after a silence.
"Yes, Abraham?" "Bain't you glad that we become gentlefolk?"
"Not particular glad."
"But you be glad that you goin' marry a gentleman?"
"What?"
said Tess, lifting her face.
"That our great relation will help 'ee to marry a gentleman?"
"Ay, our great relation? We have no such relations. What has put that into your head?"
"I heard 'em talking about it up at Rulliver's when I went to find father. There's a rich lady of our family out at Traintridge, and mother said that if you claimed kin with the lady, she'd put 'ee in the way of marrying a gentleman."
His sister became abruptly still, and lapsed into a pondering silence. Abraham talked on, rather for the pleasure of utterance than for audition, so that his sister's abstraction was of no account. He leant back against the hives, and, with upturned face, made observations on the stars, whose cold pulses were beating amid the black hollows above in serene disassociation from these two wisps of human life. He asked how far away those twinklers were, and whether God was on the other side of them. But ever and anon his childish prattle recurred to what impressed his imagination even more deeply than the wonders of creation. If Tess were made rich by marrying a gentleman, would she have money enough to buy a spyglass so large that it would draw the stars as near to her as Nettlecombe Tout? The renewed subject, which seemed to have impregnated the whole family, filled Tess with impatience.
"Never mind that now,"
she exclaimed.
"Did you say the stars were worlds, Tess?"
"Yes."
"All like ours?"
"I don't know, but I think so. They sometimes seem to be like the apples on our studded tree, most of them splendid and sound, a few blighted."
"Which do we live on, a splendid one or a blighted one?"
"A blighted one."
'Tis very unlucky that we don't pitch on a sound one, when there were so many more of 'em."
"Yes."
"Is it like that really, Tess?"
said Abraham, turning to her much impressed on reconsideration of this rare information.
"How would it have been if we had pitched on a sound one?
Well, father wouldn't have coughed and creeped about as he does, and wouldn't have got too tipsy to go on this journey, and mother wouldn't have been always washing and never getting finished."
"And would you have been a rich lady ready-made, and not have been made rich by marrying a gentleman?"
"Oh, Aby, don't talk of that any more."
Left to his reflections, Abraham soon grew drowsy. Tess was not skilful in the management of a horse, but she thought that she could take upon herself the entire conduct of the load for the present, and allow Abraham to go to sleep if he wished to do so. She made him a sort of nest in front of the hives, in such a manner that he could not fall, and taking the reins into her own hands, jogged on as before. Prince required but slight attention, lacking energy for superfluous movements of any sort. With no longer a companion to distract her, Tess fell more deeply into reverie than ever, her back leaning against the hives. The mute procession past her shoulders of trees and hedges became attached to the fantastic scenes outside reality, and the occasional heave of the wind became the sigh of some immense, sad soul, conterminous with the universe in space and with history in time. Then, examining the mesh of events in her own life, she seemed to see the vanity of her father's pride, the gentlemanly suitor awaiting her in her mother's fancy,
to see him as a grimacing personage, laughing at her poverty and her shrouded knightly ancestry. Everything grew more and more extravagant, and she no longer knew how time passed. A sudden jerk shook her in her seat, and Tess awoke from the sleep into which she too had fallen. They were a long way further down than when she had lost consciousness, and the wagon had stopped. A hollow groan, unlike anything she had ever heard in her life, came from the front, followed by a shout of, "Hoy there!" The lantern hanging at her wagon had gone out, but another was shining in her face, much brighter than her own had been. Something terrible had happened. The harness was entangled with an object which blocked the way. In consternation, Tess jumped down and discovered the dreadful truth. The groan had proceeded from her father's poor horse, Prince. The mourning mail-cart, with its two noiseless wheels, speeding along these lanes like an arrow, as it always did, had driven into her slow and unlighted equipage. The pointed shaft of the cart had entered the breast of the unhappy prince like a sword, and from the wound his life's blood was spouting in a stream and falling with a hiss onto the road. In her despair, Tess sprang forward and put her hand upon the hole, with the only result that she became splashed from face to skirt in the crimson drops. Then she stood helplessly looking on. Prince also stood firm and motionless as long as he could, till he suddenly sank down in a heap. By this time the mail-cart man had joined her, and began dragging and unharnessing the hot form of Prince. But he was already dead, and seeing that nothing more could be done immediately, the mail-cart man returned to his own animal, which was uninjured.
"You was on the wrong side," he said. "I am bound to go with the mail-bags, so that the best thing for you to do is to bide here with your load. I'll send someone to help you as soon as I can. It is getting daylight, and you have nothing to fear."
He mounted and sped on his way, while Tess stood and waited. The atmosphere turned pale. The birds shook themselves in the hedges, arose and twittered. The lane showed all its white features, and Tess showed hers still whiter. The huge pool of blood in front of her was already assuming the iridescence of coagulation, and when the sun rose, 100 prismatic hues were reflected from it. Prince lay alongside still and stark, his eyes half open, the hole in his chest looking scarcely large enough to have let out all that had animated him.
"'Tis all my doing, all mine!" the girl cried, gazing at the spectacle. "No excuse for me, none! What will mother and father live on now? Aby, Aby!"
She shook the child, who had slept soundly through the whole disaster.
"We can't go on with our load. Prince is killed!"
When Abraham realized all, the furrows of 50 years were extemporized on his young face.
"Why, I danced and laughed only yesterday," she went on to herself, "to think that I was such a fool."
"'Tis because we be on a blighted star and not a sound one, isn't it, Tess?" murmured Abraham through his tears.
In silence they waited through an interval which seemed endless. At length the sound, and an approaching object, proved to them that the driver of the mail-cart had been as good as his word. A farmer's man from near Stourcastle came up, leading a strong cob. He was harnessed to the wagon of beehives in the place of Prince, and the load taken on towards Casterbridge. The evening of the same day saw the empty wagon reach again the spot of the accident. Prince had lain there in the ditch since the morning, but the place of the blood pool was still visible in the middle of the road, though scratched and scraped over by passing vehicles. All that was left of Prince was now hoisted into the wagon he had formerly hauled,
and with his hoofs in the air and his shoes shining in the setting sunlight, he retraced the 8 or 9 miles back to Marlott. Tess had gone back earlier. How to break the news was more than she could think. It was a relief to her tongue to find from the faces of her parents that they already knew of their loss, though this did not lessen the self-reproach which she continued to heap upon herself for her negligence. But the very shiftlessness of the household rendered the misfortune a less terrifying one to them than it would have been to a striving family, though in the present case it meant ruin, and in the other it would only have meant inconvenience. In the Derbyfield countenances there was nothing of the red wrath that would have been burnt upon the girl from parents more ambitious for her welfare. Nobody blamed Tess as she blamed herself. When it was discovered that the knacker and tanner would give only a very few shillings for Prince's carcass because of his decrepitude, Derbyfield rose to the occasion.
"No," said he stoically, "I won't sell his old buddy. Not when we Durbervilles was knights in the land, we didn't sell our charges for cat's meat. Let 'em keep their shillings. He've served me well in his lifetime, and I won't part from him now."
He worked harder the next day in digging a grave for Prince in the garden than he had worked for months to grow a crop for his family. When the hole was ready, Derbyfield and his wife tied a rope round the horse and dragged him up the path towards it, the children following in a funeral train. Abraham and Liza Lou sobbed. Hope and modesty discharged their griefs in loud blares which echoed from the walls. And when Prince was tumbled in, they gathered round the grave. The breadwinner had been taken away from them. What would they do?
"Is he gone to heaven?" asked Abraham between the sobs.
Then Derbyfield began to shovel in the earth, and the children cried anew, all except Tess. Her face was dry and pale, though she regarded herself in the light of a murderess. End of chapter 4. Tess of the D'Urbervilles by Thomas Hardy, read by Adrian Pretzelis. Chapter 5. The haggling business, which had mainly depended on the horse, became disorganized forthwith. Distress, if not penury, loomed in the distance. Derbyfield was what was locally called a slack-twisted fellow. He had good strength to work at times, but the times could not be relied on to coincide with the hours of requirement, and having been unaccustomed to the regular toil of the day labourer, he was not particularly persistent when they did so coincide. Tess, meanwhile, as one who had dragged her parents into this quagmire, was silently wondering what she could do to help them out of it, and then her mother broached her scheme.
"We must take the ops with the Downs, Tess," said she, "and never more could your high blood have been found out at a more called-for moment. You must try your friends. Do ye know that there is a very rich Mrs. D'Urberville living on the outskirts of the Chase, who must be our relation? You must go to her and claim kin, and ask for some help in our trouble." "I shouldn't care to do that," says Tess. "If there is such a lady, 'twould be enough for us if she were friendly, not to expect her to give us help."
"You could win her round to do anything, my dear. Besides, perhaps there's more in it than you know of. I've heard what I've heard, good now."
The oppressive sense of the harm she had done led Tess to be more deferential than she might otherwise have been to the maternal wish, but she could not understand why her mother should find such satisfaction in contemplating an enterprise of, to her, such doubtful profit. Her mother might have made inquiries and have discovered that this Mrs. d'Urberville was a lady of unequalled virtues and charity, but Tess's pride made the part of poor relation one of particular distaste to her.
"I'd rather try to get work," she murmured.
"Durbeyfield, you can settle it," said his wife, turning to where he sat in the background. "If you say she ought to go, she will go."
"I don't like my children going and making themselves beholden to strange kin," murmured he. "I'm the head of the noblest branch of the family, and I ought to live up to it."
His reasons for staying away were worse to Tess than her own objection to going.
"Well, as I killed the horse, mother," she said mournfully, "I suppose I ought to do something. I don't mind going and seeing her, but you must leave it to me about asking for help, and don't go thinking about her making a match for me. It is silly."
"Very well said, Tess," observed her father sententiously.
"Who said I had such a thought?" asked Joan.
"I fancy it is in your mind, mother, but I'll go."
Rising early next day, she walked to the hill town called Shaston, and there took advantage of a van which, twice in the week, ran from Shaston eastward to Chaseborough, passing near Trantridge, the parish in which the vague and mysterious Mrs. d'Urberville had her residence. Tess Durbeyfield's route in this memorable morning lay amid the northeastern undulations of the vale in which she had been born, and in which her life had unfolded. The vale of Blackmoor was to her the world, and its inhabitants the races thereof. From the gates and stiles of Marlott she had looked down its length in the wandering days of infancy, and what had been mystery to her then was not much less than mystery to her now. She had seen daily from her chamber window towers, villages, faint white mansions, above all the town of Shaston, standing majestically on its height, its windows shining like lamps in the evening sun. She had hardly ever visited the place, only a small tract even of the vale and its environs being known to her by close inspection, much less had she been far outside the valley. Every contour of the surrounding hills was as personal to her as that of her relatives' faces, but for what lay beyond, her judgment was dependent on the teaching of the village school, where she had held a leading place at the time of her leaving, a year or two before this date. In those early days she had been much loved by others of her own sex and age, and used to be seen about the village as one of three, all nearly of the same year, walking home from school side by side. Tess, the middle one, in a pink print pinafore of a finely reticulated pattern, worn over a stuff frock that had lost its original colour for a nondescript tertiary, marching on long stalky legs in tight stockings which had little ladder-like holes at the knees, torn by kneeling in the roads and banks in search of vegetable and mineral treasures, her then earth-coloured hair hanging like pot-hooks, the arms of the two outside girls resting round the waist of Tess, her arms on the shoulders of the two supporters. As Tess grew older and began to see how matters stood, she felt quite a Malthusian towards her mother for thoughtlessly giving her so many little sisters and brothers, when it was such a trouble to nurse and provide for them. Her mother's intelligence was that of a happy child. Joan Durbeyfield was simply an additional one, and that not the eldest, to her own long family of waiters on Providence. However, Tess became humanely beneficent towards the little ones, and to help them as much as possible she used, as soon as she left school, to lend a hand at haymaking or harvesting on neighbouring farms, or, by preference, at milking or butter-making processes, which she had learned when her father had owned cows, and, being deft-fingered, it was a kind of work in which she excelled. Every day seemed to throw upon her young shoulders more of the family burdens, and that Tess should be the representative of the Durbeyfields at the d'Urberville mansion came as a thing of course. In this instance it must be admitted that the Durbeyfields were putting their fairest side outward. She alighted from the van at Trantridge Cross, and ascended on foot a hill in the direction of the district known as the Chase, on the borders of which, as she had been informed, Mrs. d'Urberville's seat, the Slopes, would be found. It was not a manorial home in the ordinary sense, with fields and pastures and a grumbling farmer, out of whom the owners had to squeeze an income for himself and his family by hook or by crook. It was more, far more, a country house built for enjoyment, pure and simple, with not an acre of troublesome land attached to it beyond that which was required for residential purposes, and for a little fancy farm kept in hand by the owner and tended by a bailiff. The crimson brick lodge came first in sight, up to its eaves in dense evergreens. Tess thought this was the mansion itself, till, passing through the side wicket with some trepidation, and onward to a point at which the drive took a turn, the house proper stood in full view. It was of recent erection, indeed almost new, and of the same rich red colour that formed such a contrast with the evergreens of the lodge. Far behind the corner of the house, which rose like a geranium bloom against the subdued colours around, stretched the soft azure landscape of the Chase, a truly venerable tract of forest land, one of the few remaining woodlands in England of undoubted primeval date, wherein druidical mistletoe was still found on aged oaks, and where enormous yew-trees, not planted by the hand of man, grew as they had grown when they were pollarded for boughs. All this sylvan antiquity, however, though visible from the Slopes, was outside the immediate boundaries of the estate. Everything on this snug property was bright, thriving, and well kept. Acres of glass houses stretched down the inclines to the copses at their feet. Everything looked like money, like the last coin issued from the mint. The stables, partly screened by Austrian pines and evergreen oaks, and fitted with every late appliance, were as dignified as chapels of ease. On the extensive lawn stood an ornamental tent, its door being towards her. Simple Tess Durbeyfield stood at gaze, in a half-alarmed attitude, on the edge of the gravel sweep. Her feet had brought her unto this point before she had quite realized where she was, and now all was contrary to her expectation.
"I thought we were an old family, but this is all new," she said in her artlessness.
She wished that she had not fallen in so readily with her mother's plans for claiming kin, and had endeavored to arrange assistance nearer home. The d'Urbervilles, or Stoke d'Urbervilles, as they at first called themselves, who owned all this, were a somewhat unusual family to find in such an old-fashioned part of the country. Parson Tringham had spoken truly when he said that our shambling John Durbeyfield was the only really linear representative of the old d'Urberville family existing in the county, or near it. He might have added that he knew very well that the Stoke d'Urbervilles were no more d'Urbervilles of the true tree than he was himself. Yet it must be admitted that this family formed a very good stock whereupon to regraft a name which sadly wanted such renovation. When old Mr. Simon Stoke, latterly deceased, had made his fortune as an honest merchant, some said money-lender, in the north, he decided to settle as a countryman in the south of England, and in doing this he felt the necessity of recommencing with a name that would not too readily identify him with the smart tradesman of the past, and that would be less commonplace than the original bald, stark words. Conning for an hour in the British Museum the pages of works devoted to extinct, half-extinct, obscured, and ruined families appertaining to the quarter of England in which he proposed to settle, he considered that d'Urberville looked and sounded as well as any of them, and d'Urberville accordingly was annexed to his own name for himself and his heirs eternally. Yet he was not an extravagant-minded man in this, and in constructing his family tree on the new basis was duly reasonable in framing his intermarriages and aristocratic links, never inserting a single title above a rank of strict moderation. Of this work of imagination poor Tess and her parents were naturally in ignorance, much to their discomfiture. Indeed, the very possibility of such annexations were unknown to them, who supposed that, though to be well favoured might be the gift of fortune, a family name came by nature. Tess still stood hesitating like a bather about to make his plunge, hardly knowing whether to retreat or to persevere, when a figure came forth from the dark triangular door of the tent. It was that of a tall young man, smoking. He had an almost swarthy complexion, with full lips, badly moulded, though red and smooth, above which was a well-groomed black moustache with curled points, though his age could not be more than 3 or 4 and 20. Despite the touches of barbarism in his contours, there was a singular force in the gentleman's face, and in his bold, rolling eye. "Well, my beauty, what can I do for you?" said he, coming forward, and perceiving that she stood quite confounded. "Never mind me. I'm Mr. D'Urberville. Have you come to see me or my mother?" This embodiment of a D'Urberville and a namesake differed even more from what Tess had expected than the house and grounds had differed. She had dreamed of an aged and dignified face, the sublimation of all the D'Urberville lineaments, furrowed with incarnate memories, representing in hieroglyphic the centuries of her family's and England's history. But she screwed herself up to the work in hand, since she could not get out of it, and answered, "I came to see your mother, sir." "I am afraid you cannot see her. She is an invalid," replied the present representative of the spurious house, for this was Mr. Alec, the only son of the lately deceased gentleman. "Cannot I answer your purpose? What is the business you wish to see her about?"
"It isn't business. It is—I can hardly say what."
"Pleasure?"
"Oh, no. Why, sir, if I tell you it will seem—"
Tess's sense of a certain ludicrousness in her errand was now so strong that, notwithstanding her awe of him, and her general discomfort at being there, her rosy lips curved towards a smile, much to the attraction of the swarthy Alexander.
"It is so very foolish," she stammered. "I fear I cannot tell you."
"Never mind. I like foolish things. Try again, my dear," said he kindly.
"Mother asked me to come," Tess continued, "and indeed I was in the mind to do so myself likewise. But I did not think it would be like this. I came, sir, to tell you that we are of the same family as you."
"Oh, poor relations?"
"Yes."
"Stokes?"
"No, D'Urbervilles."
I mean D'Urbervilles."
"Our names are worn away to Derbyfield, but we have several proofs that we're D'Urbervilles. Antiquarians hold we are, and we have an old seal, marked with a ramping lion on a shield, and a castle over him, and we have a very old silver spoon, round in the bowl like a little ladle, and marked with the same castle. It is so worn that my mother uses it to stir the pea soup."
"A castle argent is certainly my crest," said he blandly, "and my arms are lion rampant."
"And so mother said we ought to make ourselves be known to you, as we've lost our horse by a bad accident, and are the oldest branch of the family."
"Very kind of your mother, I'm sure, and I, for one, don't regret her step." Alec looked at Tess as he spoke in a way that made her blush a little. "And so, my pretty girl, you've come on a friendly visit to us as relations."
"I suppose I have," faltered Tess, looking uncomfortable again.
"Well, there's no harm in it. Where do you live? What are you?" She gave him brief particulars, and, responding to further inquiries, told him that she was intending to go back by the same carrier who had brought her. "It is a long while before he returns past Trantridge Cross. Supposing we walk round the grounds to pass the time, my pretty coz?" Tess wished to abridge her visit as much as possible, but the young man was pressing, and she consented to accompany him. He conducted her about the lawns, the flower-beds, and the conservatories, and thence to the fruit-garden and the greenhouses, where he asked her if she liked strawberries.
"Yes," said Tess, "when they come."
"They are already here." D'Urberville began gathering specimens of the fruit for her, handing them back to her as he stooped, and presently selecting a specially fine product of the British Queen variety, he stood up and held it by the stem to her mouth.
"No, no," she said quickly, putting her fingers between his hand and her lips. "I would rather take it by my own hand."
"Nonsense," he insisted, and, in a slight distress, she parted her lips and took it in. They had spent some time wandering desultorily thus, Tess eating in a half-pleased, half-reluctant state whatever D'Urberville offered her. When she could consume no more of the strawberries, he filled her little basket with them, and then the two passed round to the rose-trees, whence he gathered blossoms and gave her to put in her bosom. She obeyed like one in a dream, and when she could affix no more, he himself tucked a bud or two into her hat, and heaped her basket with others in the prodigality of his bounty. At last, looking at his watch, he said,
"Now, by the time you have had something to eat, it will be time for you to leave, if you want to catch the carrier to Shaston. Come here, and I'll see what grub I can find."
Stoke D'Urberville took her back to the lawn and into the tent, where he left her, soon reappearing with a basket of light luncheon, which he put before her himself. It was evidently the gentleman's wish not to be disturbed in this pleasant tete-a-tete by the servantry.
"Do you mind my smoking?" he asked.
"Oh, not at all, sir."
He watched her pretty in unconsciousness munching through the skeins of smoke that pervaded the tent, and Tess D'Urberville did not divine, as she innocently looked down at the roses in her bosom, that there behind the blue narcotic haze was potentially the tragic mischief of her drama, one who stood fair to be the blood-red ray in the spectrum of her young life. She had an attribute which amounted to a disadvantage just now, and it was this that caused Alec D'Urberville's eyes to rivet themselves upon her. It was a luxuriance of aspect, a fullness of growth, which made her appear more of a woman than she really was. She had inherited the feature from her mother without the quality it denoted. It had troubled her mind occasionally, till her companions had said it was a fault which time would cure. She soon had finished her lunch.
"Now I'm going home, sir," she said, rising.
"And what do they call you?" he asked, as he accompanied her along the drive till they were out of sight of the house.
"Tess D'Urberville, down at Marlott."
"And you say your people have lost their horse?"
"I killed him,"
she answered, her eyes filling with tears as she gave particulars of Prince's death.
"And I don't know what to do for father on account of it.
I must think if I cannot do something. My mother must find a berth for you. But, Tess, no nonsense about D'Urberville. D'Urberfield, only you know quite another name."
"I wish for no better, sir," said she, with something of dignity.
For a moment, only for a moment, when they were in the rising of the drive between the tall rhododendrons and conifers, before the lodge became visible, he inclined his face towards her as if—but no, he thought better of it, and let her go. Thus the thing began. Had she perceived this meeting's import, she might have asked why she was doomed to be seen and coveted that day by the wrong man, and not by some other man, the right and desired one in all respects, as nearly as humanity can supply the right and desired. Yet to him who amongst her acquaintance might have approximated to this kind, she was but a transient impression, half forgotten. In the ill-judged execution of the well-judged plan of things, the call seldom produces the comer. The man to love rarely coincides with the hour for loving. Nature does not often say, "See," to her poor creature at a time when seeing can lead to happy doing, or reply, "Here," to a body's cry of, "Where?" till the hide-and-seek has become an irksome, outworn game. We may wonder whether at the acme and summit of the human progress these anachronisms will be corrected by a finer intuition, a closer interaction of the social machinery than that which now jolts us round and along. But such completeness is not to be prophesied, or even conceived as possible. Enough that in the present case, as in millions, it was not the two halves of a perfect whole that confronted each other at the perfect moment. A missing counterpart wandered independently about the earth, waiting in crass obtuseness till the late time came, out of which maladroit delay sprang anxieties, disappointments, shocks, catastrophes, and passing strange destinies. When d'Urberville got back to the tent, he sat down astride on a chair, reflecting, with a pleased gleam in his face. Then he broke into a loud laugh.
"Well, I'm damned! What a funny thing! Ha, ha, ha! And what a crummy girl!"
End of chapter 5. Chapter 6 of Tests of the D'Urbervilles by Thomas Hardy. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Tests of the D'Urbervilles by Thomas Hardy, read by Adrian Pretzelis. Chapter 6. Tess went down the hill to Trantridge Cross, and inattentively waited to take her seat in the van returning from Chaseborough to Shaston. She did not know what the other occupants said to her as she entered, though she answered them. And when they had started anew, she rode along with an inward and not an outward eye. One among her fellow travellers addressed her more pointedly than any had spoken before.
"Why, you be quite a posy, and such roses in early June!"
Then she became aware of the spectacle she presented to their surprised vision. Roses at her breast, roses in her hat, roses and strawberries in her basket to the brim. She blushed, and said confusedly that the flowers had been given to her. When the passengers were not looking, she stealthily removed the more prominent blooms from her hat, and placed them in the basket, where she covered them with her handkerchief. Then she fell to reflecting again, and in looking downwards, a thorn of the rose remaining in her breast accidentally pricked her chin. Like all the cottagers of Blackmoor Vale, Tess was steeped in fancies and prefigurative superstitions. She thought this an ill omen, the first she had noticed that day. The van travelled only so far as Shaston, and there were several miles of pedestrian descent from that mountain town into the vale to Marlott. Her mother had advised her to stay here for the night at the house of a cottage woman they knew, if she should feel too tired to come on. And this Tess did, not descending to her home till the following afternoon. When she entered the house, she perceived in a moment from her mother's triumphant manner that something had occurred in the interim.
"Oh, yes, I know all about it. I told ye it would be all right, and now 'tis proved."
"Since I've been away, what has?"
said Tess, rather wearily. Her mother surveyed the girl up and down with arch approval, and went on banteringly,
"So you've brought them round?"
"How do you know, mother?"
"I've had a letter."
Tess then remembered that there would have been time for this.
"They say
Mrs. d'Urberville says that she wants you to look after a little fowl farm which is her hobby. But this is only her artful way of getting thee there without raising your hopes. She's going to own thee as kin, that's the meaning on't. But I didn't see her. You zeed somebody, I suppose. I saw her son.
And did he own ye?
Well, he called me cuz.
And I knew it. Jacky, he called her cuz, cried Joan to her husband. Well, he spoke to his mother, of course, and she do want ye there.
But I don't know that I am apt to tending fowls, said the dubious Tess.
Then I don't know who is apt. You've been born in the business and brought up in it. They that be born in a business always know more about it than any prentice. Besides, that's only just a show of something for you to do that you mightn't feel beholden.
I don't altogether think I ought to go, said Tess, thoughtfully. Who wrote the letter? Would you let me look at it?
Mrs. d'Urberville wrote it. Here it is.
The letter was in the third person, and briefly informed Mrs. d'Urberville that her daughter's services would be useful to that lady in the management of her poultry farm, that a comfortable room would be provided for her, if she could come, and that the wages would be on a liberal scale, if they liked her.
"Oh, that's all," said Tess.
"You couldn't expect her to throw her arms round ye and kiss and call ye all at once."
Tess looked out of the window. "I would rather stay here with father and you," she said.
"But why?" "I'd rather not tell you why, mother. Indeed, I don't quite know why."
A week afterwards she came in one evening from an unavailing search for some light occupation in the immediate neighbourhood. Her idea had been to get together sufficient money during the summer to purchase another horse. Hardly had she crossed the threshold before one of the children danced across the room, saying,
"The gentleman's been here."
Her mother hastened to explain. Smiles breaking from every inch of her person. Mrs. d'Urberville's son had called on horseback, having been riding by chance in the direction of Marlott. He had wished to know, finally, in the name of his mother, if Tess could really come to manage the old lady's fowl farm or not, the lad who hitherto superintended the birds having proved untrustworthy.
"Mr. d'Urberville says you must be a good girl, if you are at all as you appear. He knows you must be worth your weight in gold. He is very much interested in 'ee, truth to tell."
Tess seemed for the moment really pleased to hear that she had won such high opinion from a stranger when, in her own esteem, she had sunk so low.
"It is very good of him to think that," she murmured. "And if I was quite sure how it would be living there, I would go anywhen."
"He is a mighty handsome man."
"I don't think so," said Tess coldly.
"Well, there's your chance, whether or no. And I'm sure he wears a beautiful diamond ring."
"Yes," said little Abraham brightly from the window-bench. "And I seed it, and it did twinkle when he put his hand up to his moustaches. Mother, why did our grand relation keep putting his hand up to his moustaches?"
"Hark at that child!" cried Mrs. d'Urberville, with parenthetic admiration. "Perhaps to show his diamond ring," murmured Sir John dreamily from his chair.
"I'll think it over," said Tess, leaving the room.
"Well, she's made a conquest of the younger branch of us straight off," continued the matron to her husband. "And she's a fool if she don't follow it up." "I don't quite like my children going away from home," said the haggler. "As the head of the family, the rest ought to come to me." "But do let her go, Jacky," coaxed his poor witless wife. "He's struck with her, you can see that. He called her cuz. He'll marry her, most likely, and make a lady of her, and then she'll be what her forefathers was."
John d'Urberville had more conceit than energy or health, and this supposition was pleasant to him.
"Well, perhaps that's what young Mr. d'Urberville means," he admitted. "And sure enough he mid have serious thoughts about improving his blood by linking on to the old line. Tess, the little rogue! And have she really paid him a visit to such an end as this?"
Meanwhile Tess was walking thoughtfully among the gooseberry bushes in the garden and over Prince's grave. When she came in, her mother pursued her advantage.
"Well, what be you going to do?"
she asked.
"I wish I had seen Mrs. d'Urberville," said Tess.
"I think you mid as well settle it. Then you'll see her soon enough."
Her father coughed in his chair.
"I don't know what to say," answered the girl restlessly. "It is for you to decide. I killed the old horse, and I suppose I ought to do something to get you a new one. But I don't quite like Mr. d'Urberville being there."
The children, who had made use of this idea of Tess being shaken up by their wealthy kinfolk, which they imagined the other family to be, as a species of dolorifuge after the death of the horse, began to cry at Tess's reluctance, and teased and reproached her for hesitating.
"Tess won't go and be made a lady of. No, she says she won't,"
they wailed with square mouths.
"And we shan't have a nice new horse and lots of golden money to buy Fairlands, and Tess won't look pretty in her best clothes no more."
Her mother chimed in to the same tune. A certain way she had of making her labours in the house seem heavier than they were by prolonging them indefinitely also weighed in the argument. Her father alone preserved an attitude of neutrality.
"I will go," said Tess at last.
Her mother could not repress her consciousness of the nuptial vision conjured up by the girl's consent.
"That's right. For such a pretty maze as 'tis, this is a fine chance."
Tess smiled crossly.
"I hope it is a chance for earning money. It is no other kind of chance. You had better say nothing of that silly sort about the parish."
Mrs. d'Urberville did not promise. She was not quite sure that she did not feel proud enough, after the visitor's remarks, to say a good deal. Thus it was arranged, and the young girl wrote, agreeing to be ready to set out on any day on which she might be required. She was duly informed that Mrs. d'Urberville was glad of her decision, and that a spring-cart should be sent to meet her and her luggage at the top of the vale on the day after the morrow, when she must hold herself prepared to start. Mrs. d'Urberville's handwriting seemed rather masculine.
"A cart," murmured Joan d'Urberville doubtingly. "It might have been a carriage for her own kin."
Having at last taken her course, Tess was less restless and abstracted, going about her business with some self-assurance in the thought of acquiring another horse for her father by an occupation which would not be onerous. She had hoped to be a teacher at the school, but the fates seemed to decide otherwise. Being mentally older than her mother, she did not regard Mrs. d'Urberville's matrimonial hopes for her in a serious aspect for a moment. The light-minded woman had been discovering good matches for her daughter almost from the year of her birth. End of chapter 6